Today we want to talk about relating, and especially about how we relate to ourselves, and the way we see ourselves in the world, and how we cope with our daily lives. No man is an island, the poet sang, entire unto himself. And we have to agree that each of us is, as Don said, a part of the mainland. We are each of us a bundle of human relationships. How we've created ourselves as the persons we are today, how we got here, is bound up with our history and our relationship with other people in our lives, our interaction with them and their response to us and our responses to them. This is part of what Aristotle was referring to, and Spinoza after him, and numerous other philosophers, when they said man is a social animal. We, all of us, no matter how solitary our existence may seem at times, live in relationship with others. The quality of those relationships deeply affects our daily life. It is not only present relationships which are important in regard to our experience of today, but the way in which our parents related to each other as we were growing up, the way in which each of our parents related to us, the way in which we related to each of our parents, those things were among the most formative influences on most of us, second only to the way in which we chose to respond to the other conditions of our life since then. For even as very young children, our response to other people helped to condition the way in which they related to us. The incalculable importance of those earlier relationships ought not be underestimated. They were capable of giving us, for better or for worse, an angle of vision upon ourselves as human beings in the world and what sort of persons we were. One of the young women who took part in one of the most hideous crimes of our time, a member of the Manson family, was quoted in the newspapers as saying, "All of my life, all I ever heard was that I was going downhill. You're just going downhill," they kept telling me. "So one day I just decided to give up trying and to just go downhill." And one of the most beautiful women I know told me, "Until recently I never saw myself as good looking." And before I could utter my astonishment, she said, "Oh, I know that now. I discovered it in therapy. But I didn't know it before. Why, when I was in the sixth grade," she said, "I remember running all the way home from school, just dancing with joy, because I was so overjoyed to be able to tell my mother that I thought there was an uglier girl than me who had just entered the sixth grade. I suppose it was because my father used to say things to me like, 'Not bad for an ugly little girl,' or 'How's my ugly duckling today?' He's dead now, so I can't ask him if he was trying to keep me from growing up conceited because I was so beautiful, or if he thought he was being funny. I just don't know. I do know that I grew up thinking I was really ugly to look at." It's not only our relationships with our parents, however, which helped form our view of ourselves, but also our relationship with our peers in those days and with other significant adults. Often in counseling sessions, I have met adults who, because of some wound delivered by a second grade teacher or a third grade classmate, is today hampered in his or her ability to relate well to other people. The reason such childhood experiences can be so influential in helping or hindering us is that we were only then beginning to get an understanding of how the world looked at us, what we looked like in the eyes of others. And so our vision then being rather uncritical, we being terribly vulnerable, we took in whole perhaps certain episodes and often internalized judgments about ourselves made by others and made those our own judgments on ourselves. But the impact of relationships doesn't stop there, of course. Even today, our relationships with our peers and our interaction with the people with whom we work, our interaction with our various friends, for those of us who have friends, and there are many in our midst who don't, our relationship with our wives or husbands or children or with significant other persons in our lives, continues to be for us the source of worry or delight, of pain or pleasure, of fear or ecstasy, laughter or tears, headaches, or the tender moments when love shines through soft eyes. It's in the hard or soft eyes of other people, in their admiring gaze or their look of disdain, that we continue even now to get messages about ourselves. Naturally, today as adults, we have built some defense mechanisms for ourselves. If we don't care for this particular other person, we can discount his or her message out of hand if we bother to notice it at all. It's precisely when we have some concern for the other or care for the other's opinion of us that the message gains in importance. The relationship we have with others or want to have with the other is what gives such communications of theirs to us their significance, their power, their weight. Now, in the second talk in this series, we'll be examining our relationship with other people in some detail and dealing with communications and how we commune with others. And in our third session, we're going to look at family relationships in particular. And in the fourth talk, we'll look at our specifically sexual relating. Today, I'd like to look at the contribution which we as individuals bring to any relationship we have or may be involved in. For the fact is that it is we ourselves who make the most significant contribution to the quality of all of our adult relationships, a fact which I hope will become clear before we've concluded our remarks here. And if we desire to work some improvements in how we're relating to other people in our lives, one of the most fruitful places to begin that task is to take a look at how we're relating to ourselves. How do we see ourselves? The way we view ourselves as beings in the world. One of the most useful experiments I conduct, experiences if you will, with certain clients is to very literally show them how they see themselves. I've had occasion during an initial session with someone who was troubled by loneliness or who had gotten himself or herself involved in a relationship which was extremely painful to them or was degrading to them, to ask them to stand beside me in front of a full-length mirror and take a good look at himself or herself there. And then I've asked that they tell only the good features they view in that person looking back at them out of the mirror. And they are only to describe that person in the most positive terms. I request them to tell that person they see there what his or her finest physical features are. Very seldom, for any of those individuals, do the first sentences come out without negatives. There are things like, you have nice eyes, but your nose is crooked, or you've got a pretty smile, but you've got a weak chin, and so on. As I ask them to delete the negatives, the task becomes most difficult. That is when the person is able to carry through with that experience at all. On two occasions in recent weeks, I had individuals who were incapable of seeing anything good about themselves, and one simply wept and turned away saying, "I have never seen anything good in a mirror." And when I said to one client, "What if I said that you had very beautiful and expressive eyes?" She responded, "I don't believe you. I don't see that." The experiment is useful, for it leads us immediately to the core of the problem of such persons. They are not relating well to others, and they create their own loneliness, and they participate in relationships that are brutalizing them because they don't feel they have any real attraction to other people or for others. In the case of the woman involved in the terribly degrading relationship, the first session led to her admission before it was through that she felt that that was all she deserved, that she might not hope for anything better, being such a lousy person. As an adjunct to this experience, I often have the same clients then sit down and tell me verbally what they consider to be their personality traits, their qualities as a human being that make them valuable persons to know. What are their positive attributes, and what is it that they have to offer the world of people around them? And the very difficulty they experience in doing this task is revelatory to them again of the degree to which they are crippling themselves in their struggle to enjoy more rewarding relationships with other persons. If I maintain a low self-image, if I hold myself in low esteem, I am going to almost automatically hold myself back from others, and that is part of the relational problem. The fact is that when others do make the first overture, though, when others do make a step towards me, or do extend themselves to me in friendship or love, if I have that sort of opinion of myself that I've been describing, I'm going to find it extremely difficult to accept that extended hand. Like the young woman who was not attractive and who did have beautiful and expressive eyes said, "I don't believe you." And many people do that when others come towards them in friendship. Or else they say, "What's wrong with him or her that he or she should find something good in me? They must be crazy." Even when not rejecting so abruptly that message of the other that could be the foundation for a relationship, the person of low self-image will not believe it at all and will wonder what's wrong with the person saying it, or may look for an ulterior motive. One client, when I had offered that kind of hint about a good quality, said simply, "You're saying that only because you're my therapist." In other words, they felt that I was being paid to say something like that. Now, when we feel this way about ourselves, then we've raised an obstacle to effective relating to other people around us, and we've raised it. The other people haven't. So it might be well for us to consider as homework doing on our own the two exercises I've just described and seeing how well you do at them. You know, you can, if you've got a family, you can shoo them out of the bathroom and look in the full-length mirror. They'll just think you've gone off your rocker as you talk to yourself in there. But if you don't have, try it anyway. And see if you can get through a few minutes of description of yourself that is positive and seeing only your positive qualities. So often, especially among Christians, we only examine ourselves for our sins, for our failings, so that we can apologize and seek forgiveness. But these two exercises may help you to balance the books, because you can examine yourselves both in the mirror and on paper, for I'd suggest that you write out the appreciation profile of yourself so you can read it over later, for your virtues and your good qualities, so that the books can be balanced. Very few of us have escaped some blows to our self-esteem at some point or another in our lives. Still, it is our response in the present to those experiences which helps to make or unmake us in terms of our effective relating to other people as they enter the orbit of our lives. And the creative response in the here and now is to confront those experiences of the past and recognize that while they cannot be changed, we might in the present work some changes in our present view of ourselves. You see, opposed to the, in a sense, to the person who only sees the worst in himself, there's another sort of person who raises a slightly different barrier, but in the same fashion, because of their view of themselves, against relating. One of the ways in which we often succeed in keeping ourselves entrapped in ourselves and lessening the quality of our relationships is that we don't want to confront our darker side, that we don't look into our past to see exactly what happened to us or what our weaknesses are or what our sinfulness might be. We feel we have to pretend to a virtue, if only to set a good example for the kids or something like that. And so we try not to express any weakness at all. Or maybe we're so afraid of failing, of falling, or of making a mistake, that we really rigidify and put strong strictures on our lives, that we suppress our anger and, of course, end up suppressing our joy, too, because we're repressing our feelings. And we do not give vent to any but a very rigid profile of ourselves to other people. And this path leads to putting an obstacle against others getting too close to us. For we tend then to be judgmental, to stand aloof, to be unwilling to bend or to unbend, to be rigid in our lives and make ourselves unapproachable. So the path to maturity, it seems to me, lies in our being willing to look at ourselves as whole persons, as human beings. And that means that we recognize our faults and our contradictions and accept them. and that we are able to say, you know, I know I can get angry, but that doesn't mean I'm always angry. Or I know I've done some things I'm not proud of, but that doesn't make me a hopeless case. Or I've made my share of mistakes and failed more than once, but I don't view myself as a failure. Point of fact, if you haven't made any mistakes, you haven't learned anything, you know. I mean, I've never learned a damn thing from any success I've ever had. You know, I've only learned from falling on my face, and I think the same goes for most people. Growing up human requires that we look at ourselves clearly and see seeing the beautiful eyes in the mirror as well as the wart, and seeing the mistakes and the successes and recognizing our sins, but also recognizing our good deeds. I think that's the crucial point, that there in coping with ourselves and becoming more aware of the fullness of ourselves, of balancing those books out, we make ourselves more human. And you and I have power in our lives and power over our lives to make changes. Too many of the sad faces at the stoplights, too many of the hypochondriacs in the doctor's offices, the professional smilers on planes and sales offices whose eyes betray their unhappiness, are persons who have neglected to confront the reality of their own power to change themselves and their relationships with others. And the first step to that is, of course, changing oneself. It's the first step towards rebuilding or laying the foundation stone for improving the life situation of those who come to me seeking help, is to take a look at themselves and see what they're doing to themselves. It's surely the secret of those we meet who seem to confront life with an openness and a vitality that we ourselves envy. When you felt depressed, hasn't it been because you felt helpless or a sense of being overpowered by the situation? We've yielded to the notion of ourselves as some sort of passive victim of circumstance, a leaf blown by the wind, I don't know what to do, I can't do anything sort of attitude. Consider for a moment the experience you've had of meeting someone who is enjoying their life, whose energy level is quite high, who greeted you with enthusiasm that was genuine. It may have been only a momentary encounter. Even a few minutes in that person's company seems to lift you up and to charge you with energy. And consider the last time you met someone who was acting out the role of perpetual victim of life, a passive, tired, and depressed individual. And didn't you lose some energy, some of your own elan, some of your vitality, and didn't you feel just a bit burdened and drained by that momentary encounter? And which one are you when others come along to confront you? For what we bring to any relationship is nothing more or less than who we are at this moment of our lives. Our contribution to any relationship is ourselves and our present style of being in the world. And so we don't even have to say a word to others to communicate that. Our very body stance speaks to them, be they strangers or friends. Our eyes speak and our handshake speaks. In our relationship with other people, just the way we look at them can take strength away or give it to them, as well as our own energy level. That's what I'm talking about. Now, you and I have something to say about the level of our physical energy and about the quality of the way we look at people, whether with hard eyes or soft. We have even more to say about the quality of our relationships with others. Very often I'm confronted by one party to a marriage who comes in for counseling because the other party won't show up, so they come in alone. The other party is reluctant to come in for help. Often the person who comes in is suffering great pain and feels a victim of the situation. And very often when I ask them what they're after, they're seeking some advice. Now, I don't give advice. That's for Abigail Van Buren. So instead of advice, the individual finds, hopefully, some guidance necessary to discovering their own power and their own control over their own lives and the ability to build up their own energy levels physically and mentally, so that they can work some changes in the situation. You might ask how that's done. Well, consider for a moment, as one example, the fact that it takes two, this will be a very simple example, it takes two of us to put on a skit. If you remember your high school skits or grammar school skits or something, it takes two to do that, or a play. And a lot of people are involved in skits that they keep repeating over and over again that keep damaging them. They're the one that gets clubbed with a baseball bat in the skit, you see. And if I don't deliver the lines you expect of me, though, then you've got to ad lib. I've just thrown the script out the window. And if I don't stand in the usual place where you hit me over the head with the baseball bat, then you're going to miss hitting me over the head with the baseball bat. So in other words, your behavior has to change if I change mine. And in relational situations, I am fond of saying there are no unwilling victims. There are persons who simply have not seen the options open to them to stop their collaboration in a situation which has been a source of pain or continuing distress to them. So by taking charge of my share of any relationship, by making changes in me and the way I'm responding to this situation, I empower myself, and rightfully so, to become co-creator of that relationship rather than a victim of it. But there is more to empowering myself than this. Take the matter of time, for instance. Within certain limits, say the 8 hours a day you have to be on the job, your time is really your own. And how we spend our time, particularly the 16 hours a day when we're not earning a living, is our own choice, assuming that most of us have little choice about whether or not we're going to hold a job, though we did have some choice about the sort of job we're going to hold. Yet many people behave as if time were their enemy, or that they were swept up in a sort of current of time over which they had no control, rather than being their lifetime. They speak of having to do this or that, as though somebody's out there with a whip causing them to do this. It's Wednesday, I have to do the laundry. Why? You know, why Wednesday, etc. They rush down the freeway in order to, you know, and raise hell with all the other motorists, for example, and then you find out why the rush, why the anger, why the frustration, why the hurry to get there, when they get there, all they do is mix a drink and sit down in front of the TV until dinner, you know. Or they hurry off to the happy hour at the corner bar before going home, and the happy hour leaves them depressed, as often or not. They've just killed a little time. It's always depressing to kill time, because time is our life. If I run out of time, I'm dead. Huh? The singles bars in this city, the meat racks, are full of lonely people whose thirst for meaningful relationships is most likely not going to be quenched there, where they do spend some of their evenings. Many lock themselves into patterns of behavior like this, which are truly a waste of time, a killing of their lifetime, and then they speak of their boring lives, or of their, you know, how they're bored, that there's no meaning in their existence. But our time is under our control. It is our lifetime, as I say. Consider for a moment the fact that everything I read, every bit of situation comedy I watch on TV, every insane conversation I get into, becomes a part of my existence. It helps to make me who I am, not just at that moment, but for the future. I've just added it to my history. Every day I'm creating my autobiography, right? You too. Today you're writing another page in your autobiography in the creation of your life. Consider further that it's a fact that the time I spend on this or that, whether this or that is frivolous or worthwhile or whatever in anybody else's estimation, is time I might, let's say though that I'm wasting my time watching TV, but there's a choice I made, say, to watch that. But the thing is that it's not just what's coming into me from that, it's what I'm not doing that I might be doing instead of this, that might be more beneficial to me and strengthen me more. Because here, in the choice of the use of my time, I have great power. Is there something else that I might do which would elevate my spirits, add to my enjoyment of myself and my life, and therefore strengthen me in my confrontation with others, in my relationships with others? If I only had this evening for the rest of my life, would I spend it the way I'm spending it? What would I do with it? And how do I know it isn't the rest of my life? You know, in looking at our lives, it's not too good to ignore the fact of death. I've often commented that in my life, the greatest gift was given me when I experienced the nearness of being killed. And it was then that I learned how precious the present moment could be, and how good the earth could smell, and how nice it was to be able to breathe and to walk upright, and also how important certain things were and how unimportant so many things I thought were important were. Someone once asked St. François de Sales, who was playing billiards at the time, he was a 17th century French gentleman, you know, what he would do if he only had 5 minutes to live, if somebody came up to him and told he only had, in the next 5 minutes, he was going to be dead. And he paused for a moment, he thought about that, he looked at the individual, and he said, as he leaned across to hit the next ball, he said, "I'd finish the game." I think that question is one we ought to pose to ourselves every so often, for each of us owes God a death, and none of us knows the hour. Are we putting into this day, into this evening, into the time we have at hand, the appreciation of life we might have if that was all the time we had? And the fact is, with the past dead and gone and the future not here yet, the present is all the time we have. This day isn't going to come again, and it can't be relived, so I may as well live it to the best now. And the young woman of 30 who went to for a routine physical examination and got the notice she had but a few weeks to live wept bitterly at how she had been cheated out of life. Yet the fact is that she had been gifted with 30 years of life, and a few weeks more of life was ahead of her. There were 1 million babies last year who were not given the chance for 30 minutes, let alone 30 years of life. This is not to imply that woman's suffering ought not to touch us, but it's to illustrate the truth that we ought not think of life as some infinite stretch of time, as an irrevocable gift. None of us who has been born has been cheated out of life, however short or long a time we may have lived. What matters is not the longevity of our span, but what we do with the time at hand and how creatively we use it in creating ourselves and our lifetime, so that we appreciate our liveliness. Now, some spend their lives deadening their sensibilities with drugs like alcohol, or hiding out from true encounters with others, or masking themselves in one conceit or another, and that's a waste too. And some waste their days in pitying themselves for not having been born into a different family, apparently unaware that if they were born into a different family, they wouldn't be who they are, you know, the somebody they are, but someone else. To truly appreciate the gift of life, I think we have to be aware that it's a gift and try to be grateful for that. You know, I think that gratitude rises spontaneously if you recognize it as a gift. Not long ago, I was at a small dinner where a woman was present who was very active politically in campaigns and so on and in other ways, and she's got a fatal illness. It gets progressively worse, and she doesn't have too many years ahead of her. And she is a family woman. And somewhere in the conversation, the name of a politician came up, and she said, "I can't stand him." She said, "I don't hate him," she said. "You know, I only have so much energy, so I don't waste it hating anybody. But I simply just can't stand him. I mean, I prefer not to think of him because I don't want to spend the energy on that either." And I thought it was a beautiful remark for a woman who spends a lot of her energy visiting people who have just been told that they have the same disease she has, and giving them confidence and hope, because she doesn't have the energy to waste on hating people. She's too busy loving them. I think we'd have a lot less hate in the world if more people realized that they were wasting energy that could be spent in loving. For when we come down to the nitty-gritty of what makes life worth living, it is, after all, loving. Very often, the way in which we treat the time we have, the way in which we're using our time, is bound up with our attitude towards what's going on, or the environment, our surroundings. For many people, their play time, their recreation time, a time when they're supposed to be charging their batteries and getting some new energy, is not that at all. It seems to further deplete them. An awful lot of people spend their time, you know, at a job to earn money to buy a color TV that encourages them to buy products they don't need in order to, quote, be happy, which keeps them on the treadmill, and then they wonder why life seems to be rushing them by, and they don't stop the clock and take time to nurture themselves. Now, last Friday, I was out on the bay and on the ocean salmon fishing, and I enjoyed catching 3 salmon, and some friends and I have enjoyed eating one of them together, and we'll be smoking the others, and so on. There was another passenger on that boat who felt he had wasted his day because he didn't catch a fish. Now, I go salmon fishing because I find the rhythm of the day at sea very peaceful, relaxing, and truly recreative. In that fashion, he and I had each determined the impact of what was going on and how it would affect us. He was disappointed because all he wanted out of the day was fish. If he didn't catch one, it unmanned him. And what I wanted out of the day was a day on the ocean. And the fish were just a bonus, you see. I spent another day recently in a leisurely stroll around the area down here, enjoying the different pulse beat of life of the streets and the faces, different from the trout streams, which I love also. And it's not the environment, it's not the surroundings that really matter. These are all different experiences that any of us can enjoy, but the enjoyment comes out of our attitude towards them and our awareness of the if you will, the sanctity of the present moment. Now, it's taken me a while in my life to learn to enjoy being where I am, wherever that is. And part of that learning entailed becoming aware of what it was I wanted out of life and could appreciate out of being where I was at a given time. I'm very glad I've learned that kind of lesson, and I'm still learning it and applying it, because there was a time when I permitted my surroundings to determine how I felt, the people I was with to determine my mood, rather than choosing how I was going to shape up and create the situation. Because by letting circumstance or my surroundings or other people decide my feeling states, I am handing over power to those other people or things or those circumstances. The fact is that it's my response to the circumstances of my life and to the environment surrounding me and the events and persons in my life that help to create me and my life. And all of us need to accept that responsibility, that understanding and awareness of our ability to respond as we choose to. And the same goes for our initiative taking as well as our responses. Any salesperson here knows that the quickest way to lose a sale is to say to the prospective customer, "I don't suppose you'd be interested in," because of course they can automatically say, "No, I'm not, you know, you supposed right." They are agreeing with you. They don't have to be disagreeable. "Well, this may not interest you, but..." "No, it doesn't interest me." And the person may not know that that's the way they're doing it, but they've just set things up so that they can come back to the office and say, "Nobody's interested." Often in our relationships, our presentation of ourselves is just that way. We set ourselves up for rejection by saying or by projecting the attitude to other people of, "I'm nobody you'd be interested in." Or maybe simply hanging back and not saying anything because, "Well, I don't think my opinion would count with you, so I don't offer it at all." Perhaps I might consider why I behave this way in a given situation if I'm aware of it. And maybe by reflecting on it, I recall that my father said children should be seen and not heard. Or maybe my contributions at the family dinner table were considered interruptions and not important. The fact is, though, that even if that's true, I am no longer a child at the family dinner table, and so I can decide to behave differently as the adult I am in the present. One way of getting a handle on our relating to others is to spend some time during the next week in being aware of how we present ourselves to someone we've just met, how we're behaving at a social gathering, what information about ourselves do we trot out at the very first opportunity, what stories do we tell, and how many times have we followed that same pattern. What are we trying to say about ourselves to this other person by that piece of information or that story? And how much are we listening to the others? What magazines did we read this week and why? And what does our favorite sport say about us? And take last night, where did you go and what did you do? And where, who were you with? And what does that tell you about you? Consider the last time someone told you how they felt. Had you felt the same way? And how did you respond to that expression of their feeling? And what does that say about the way you're relating to others and the way you're creating your world? We're all making that kind of choice all day long. And in those choices, we're saying, "This is what I want to do and where I want to go and how I want to be." Yet that sentence may not ring true to some present. Because if you're made uncomfortable by that statement, I ask you to be aware of the discomfort and see what it is you might want to change. For your discomfort is telling you something. Telling you about the need for change. We simply cannot win a race we aren't running if I am not aware of the multitude of choices that are open to me in creating myself and my lifestyle, and therefore being a major ingredient of my relationships, then I'm not exercising my freedom to be and behave as I desire, but casting myself in the role of a victim. Some of us feel fragmented or pulled in many directions by different functions or duties we may have. But if we feel fragmented, it may be that some of those functions and duties are at war with the others. I often think about this in terms of the fact that I wear a lot of hats. You know, somebody says, what do you do? And I find it difficult to pin it down to one thing. This week I'll spend 2.5 days at an institute. I have one other lecture to give this week. I'll be seeing a number of clients this week. I have 3 chapters of another person's book to edit. I have a chapter of a text for a national program to do, carrying on a normal social life and so on. It's all very fragmented, you see, and I could feel pulled in different directions, except that I freely choose to do all of those things. I could have chosen not to, or I could choose to do something else. And so those things become an overflow of my choice. And so I'm doing something that is an exercise of my own feeling of power. The more we feel in control of our lives, then, the less we feel fragmented. And the more we take control over our own lives, the more whole we feel, the better we feel about ourselves and the quality of our lives. And that good feeling becomes part of the present that we make to others when we greet them. This talk would not be complete without some comments about those who are lonely. It's our very being as social animals, to use the philosopher's term we cited earlier, that makes the experience of ourselves of loneliness possible. The experience of loneliness is not unique to anybody in this room. Everybody here has experienced loneliness, if they're not experiencing it now, whether they're married, single, young, or old. It is part of the condition of life. And it's again what we do about it that matters. Some close themselves in upon their loneliness, creating an even greater sense of isolation and alienation. But if we can even begin to recognize that loneliness is a universal human experience, that everybody knows it, and some people around us are going through it right now, then we have a common ground for relating to them because we've both shared that experience. We need not be alone in our loneliness, then. If we reach the point of recognizing it in others and seeking appropriate ways of meeting their need for companionship, there are all kinds of lonely children and lonely senior citizens, as well as lonely steward eye and lonely salesmen in our midst, and we ought to introduce them to one another or ourselves to them. A city like San Francisco, beautiful and civilized as it is, spawns loneliness. A person can feel lost and alienated in any city. And the some of us may complain, well, I want to have better relationships, or I want to have more friends, or I just want to have some friends in this city, but I just can't seem to change my life, or that I don't seem to meet anybody, and so on. And talk about power in my life doesn't apply to me because I can't seem to make anything go the way I want it to go. Now, I have therapist friends who would call that resistance, but I don't like labeling people. I'd simply ask you to get in touch with that response, with that resistance, if you will, if it's yours, and honestly look at what you might be saying and what's behind such a protest. Because often enough, when working with clients who come up with that kind of excuse or rationale or protestation, I found with them in their exploration of themselves that what's holding them back is that they fear the notion of changing their lives. They might jump from the frying pan of misery into the fire of greater misery, they feel. The present misery is better than something new or untried, and their sense of failure is at least familiar to them. They've made an old friend, you see, and their sense of loneliness, and so they would prefer to stick with that rather than risk change. Besides, they might end up not having anybody or anything but themselves to pin the rap on for being the way they are. Or perhaps the situation seems so overwhelming because it's a sense of unhappiness with all sorts of things going on in our lives today. I'd suggest if you recognize yourself in any part of that quick sketch, particularly the fact that, well, everything's out of control in my life, I have to do this, I have to do that, I'm meeting this, and they're all problems and unhappy in all these areas, that you face the fact that none of us can change all those areas overnight or even make a major change overnight. But that one of the ways of handling that is to look at the things that are bothering you and confront those things squarely, even make a little list of them. Write it down. It always helps to write things down. and then consider one of those items and some options you might have in regard to a minor change, just a small change in that one area that might improve things. And choose a change that is positive, that doesn't depend upon anybody else but you, and that you can start in on immediately and apply for a week. See how it works. And at the end of the week, evaluate how it works. And if it works, stay with it and then tackle one of the other things that's bothering you. And very often there's a transference value. How do you apply this to loneliness? Well, you might look at how you're scheduling your evenings. Perhaps you build loneliness into them by simply going home, cooking dinner for yourself, ironing or watching TV, and going to bed to do the same thing the next day. Then you wonder why life is boring while living for the weekend when you'll go out with the old standbys. Consider other possibilities, and these are just examples of a list that's literally endless. You could decide to invite someone from the office to dinner once a week, different person. You might look at the paper for the upcoming seminars. You might volunteer one night a week for some ongoing community service organization or a crises hotline. Or you might join your church adult discussion group, which meets weekly. Or you might go belly dancing class or yoga or take an evening course or something. You might, depending on your interests, join the Friends of the Public Library, volunteer for campaign work or for a candidate, join a theater group or a group interested in some hobby of yours, or resurrect an old one that you can use as a locus for joining a group. All of these will bring you into contact with people who are sharing your own interests, and many of them are at the same time performing a public service for the community at large. For you see, happiness is not to be grasped at. We can't chase after a sense of fulfillment. We find those things by moving out towards others, not in the artificial and exploitative atmosphere of a singles bar where everybody has but one thing on their minds, but in doing things that we enjoy doing, or doing things that are of some service to others, and entering areas which involve others while developing our own intellectual, physical, or emotional resources and making ourselves feel better. We're placing ourselves then in situations which help us to enlarge our horizons, and at the same time to meet other persons who are sharing some common ground of appreciation with us. In making such practical choices, we ought to keep in mind that it should first of all be practical, as I say, that we can do it, that we don't need anybody else to help us do it, that we consider it a positive and appropriate step for ourselves. And after a few weeks or a month, we might reevaluate that plan and see how it worked out and see if we want to make a change. A final note. Only you are capable of being you. Sometimes what is impeding your relationship with another may be that you are trying to be somebody other than who you really are. Trying to mind read others and to puzzle out what they want of you and then trying to be that person is not only a losing game in terms of authentic relating, because it's phony to begin with, it's literally self-destructive inasmuch as it furthers your own sense of alienation from your real self. Every individual one of us was created absolutely unique, and there will never be a duplicate of any of us on the face of this earth. So don't waste your time trying to be somebody else when you're an original. The adventure of discovering yourself is one of the great delights of life, and you might devote a little more time in this coming week to the simple task of becoming more aware of the positive messages people are sending you. We delete a lot of the news that people send us, the good news about ourselves. We discount it. We shove it aside. I'd like you to pay attention to that this week, if you would. And accepting them and letting them nourish you, those positive messages, is a good start, too, on rebuilding yourself for better relationships. Then, too, spend some time considering yourself as somebody worth knowing better and seeing what you can do about getting better acquainted with yourself in a number of ways, some of those I've suggested. You deserve a treat, for example. So decide each day this week to give yourself something nice. You know, it may be a hot bath with 4711 foaming bath oil, or it may be an ice cream cone, or it may be that you'll throw yourself an unbirthday party. You know, it not being your birthday, you can throw a party for yourself. It may be a long-distance call to a friend across the country you haven't heard from in a while. Give yourself a treat. It may be a session on the table of a good massage therapist. Whatever it may be, treat yourself like the precious human being you are.